For amber waves of gray, for purple mountains' majesties, above the fruited land, America, America, God shed his grace on thee.
Something, wasn't it? Amen. God's truth is marching on. Can we say amen to that one more time?
Amen.
Amen. I say every Sunday, isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
And I mean that. I mean that even especially today. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. at the risk of preaching much of my sermon right now in the next couple of minutes, I want us to focus our thinking today. I don't know about you, but this has been an emotional week. Penn State lost yesterday. I came to understand that after watching Georgia lose to some terrible team in Florida. It's emotional at my house.
Maryland won.
Boo. All right. And we had a presidential election on Tuesday. For some, the result is something to cheer. For others, the result is something to be saddened by. But I say this to you, and this is the whole point of my sermon today, God is still in control. It matters less to me who sits behind the desk in the Oval Office than who sits on the throne. Amen. Now understand, I say that as someone who is a political guy. I go to rallies, I vote, I get engaged in those things. I enjoy our democracy and our process. I believe it is incumbent upon Christians to get involved. And if you did not vote this year, I encourage you, exercise your right to vote prayerfully and carefully. But who we serve, where our identity comes from, the one who holds my future, yes, is the King of Glory.
Right.
Come on now. You want to be sad? Be sad. You want to be happy? Be happy. But now's the time for the church to go to work because the harvest field is ripe. And our obligation, our responsibility is to do the work of the Lord. And please don't misunderstand what I'm about to say. I'm not comparing myself to Jesus. But I believe this very much when he said to his parents when they found him in the temple, "Don't you know I should be about my Father's business?" Those should be the words that are on our lips right now. Don't you know?
Yes.
Don't you know? Don't you understand?
Yes.
You see, church, we are on an intersecting timeline with the book of Revelation. The rapture of the church. Jesus Christ is coming soon. I think I was listening to the praise team practice this morning. Let me tell you, they're limbering up the trumpet in heaven right now.
Yes.
Putting a little oil on the valve, you know, and getting their lips all wet, ready to get a good seal, ready to blow.
Yes.
Our words must be, "I'm about my Father's business."
Yes.
And my Father's business is winning the lost and discipling the found. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go to the Lord with some scripture and some prayer. Psalm chapter 47, verses 1 and 2 say this. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Let's do that. Clap your hands. Come on. Shout to God with the voice of triumph. Come on. Amen. For the Lord Most High is awesome. He is the great King over all the earth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. We've got several prayer requests today. A brother from Clappertown, Jim McNally, I believe, is...
Negley.
Boy, I got that. Thank you. I better not get any more names wrong today. I might lose control of this crowd. Brother Jim, how about that? I knew I'd get the first name right. We want to remember him in prayer. He's in the hospital right now suffering from COVID. Our COVID numbers across the county are going up. We want to remember every single person. We want to remember the family of Olga Steele. Why is that name hard for me to say? This lady passed away this week on Monday. She was 100 years old. Imagine. Come on. Imagine all the things that she saw and experienced in her lifetime. I was thinking about that. We did her funeral yesterday, and she went from horses to cars to airplanes to space shuttles. She saw indoor plumbing and TVs and computers. Just great triumphs.
Yeah. Amen.
What an amazing life, 100 years old, God willing. Maybe that'll be our story. But I don't want to live 1 minute past the rapture, you know what I'm saying? All right. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you today, Lord. We honor you today. We are here, Lord, to glorify you, to worship you, to let you know, Lord, that we know who our source is, who our strength is, who our identity is. Lord, we praise your holy name. We love you today. And Lord, we pray for those that are sick in body today, Lord, those that need a special touch. We pray, Lord, that you will move upon them. Lord, we pray that you will touch them, that you will heal them. And Lord, I pray that for all people, Lord, that are deeply feeling this election, Lord, I pray that you will touch their hearts today and remind them, Lord, that you're in control. Lord, we dedicate this service to you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, as you know, today is Veterans Day.
Amen.
And while this COVID stuff has prevented us from doing some of our normal things, we're hoping and believing that next year we're going to be back on track doing our typical Veterans Day services. But we still want to honor our veterans today. So with that, I want to give the platform to Brother Darrell, and he's going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please join with me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty, justice for all.
You may be seated. We're going to play a little video here with our military themes, our military fight songs. And when you hear your branch's song, stand up. All right? Can we do that? All right. Fire us off there, Steve.
Shout, counter marching on the
Come on, makes you want to run out and enlist, doesn't it? Thank you to each and every person that served. You have brought great honor. Great honor. And to our newest soldier, not a veteran yet, just because you're still serving. But Jonah, we're very proud of you, young man. Amen. Come on. Well, I tell you, I love those songs. They get the juices flowing. Now we're going to watch something that I find illuminating. Brother Rich has put this video together in the last several years, and it's got a lot of pictures of you as soldiers when you were younger. I don't know how to break this to a few of y'all, but you might have gotten old. I don't know. But enjoy this little video montage here. Amen. My father and my grandfather both served. My grandfather was in the Army Air Corps way back when, and he served during World War II and trained airplane mechanics in Dothan, Alabama. He was very excited that the Germans and the Japanese never overran Dothan, Alabama. He was proud of his efforts there. What's funny, my grandfather couldn't fly and was terribly afraid of heights, but he trained people on airplane engines. It's kind of scary. And then I was telling somebody the other day, he finished his enlistment, got out, tried to farm, that didn't work, tried to run a funeral home, that didn't work, tried to run a gas station, that didn't work, and he went back into the Air Force and spent 25 years there. And then my dad served during the Vietnam era in the Air Force as well. He was a company clerk. So I am honored to be with you and honored to be your pastor, and thank you so much for your service. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to do a couple other things for our veterans. Our kids have a performance here in just a few minutes, and we got a gift for each of you, but we still have a little church business we need to take care of. So if our ushers will come forward at this time. I want to remind you about our Wednesday night Bible study. We're in the book Overcomer by Dr. David Jeremiah. It really has been a great study. We're just 2 weeks into it. So feel free to jump in with us on Wednesday night. We meet in here at 6:30 for prayer. And then we go into the annex at 7 for our class. For a while, we got out of the habit of meeting for prayer. You know, the church was closed for in-service meetings for so long, and so I think that we've kind of gotten out of that habit. But I encourage you, make a commitment that this week at 6:30 that you'll join us here in the sanctuary. We spread out all over the place, and we pray. And we pray for each other, we pray for our community, we pray for our country, and then we go study the word of the Lord together. Amen? Amen. If you will, take your tithe and your offering into your hand, and let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you, we worship you, Lord. We thank you. Lord, we thank you for our veterans. Lord, we thank you for those that have served so diligently and faithfully. And Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and how, Lord, that you are holding us even now in the palm of your hand. So, Lord, I pray that you will receive our tithe and our offering and that it will be a blessing to you and a blessing to this community. In your name we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Good morning. I'd like to start off by saying thank you to each of you who gave your time and your service to give us our freedom that we enjoy here in America. I'm going to start off with a poem. It says, "Dear hero, who walks among us, you never look for glory or praise. You only wish to help, serve, and save. You're selfless and fair. You're the protector of freedom. You do what is right. We appreciate you every day and every night. We hope that you know how much you mean to us. Without your service and sacrifice, we would all lose this gift that means so much. Thank you for your service. We pray for your safety. We believe in you and support you every step of the way." Our kids have a song they're going to do, and then we have a few poems from the kids that they're going to read. And then we're going to do a grand old flag, and they're going to wave their flags for you. So if the kids can all come up front, we'll do our song. All right, spread out here. got those? You guys ready? Miss Holly's holding your words in case you forget them.
Veterans Day is an official United States holiday which honors people who have served in our armed services. These men and women are known as veterans. It is a federal holiday that is observed on November 11th. Veterans Day is a day set aside that helps us remember the anniversary of the end of World War I. World War I battles were formally ended on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918. We remember Veterans Day each year as a time to be dedicated to the cause of world peace. We thank all our veterans for serving and giving to make our country free, peaceful, and strong.
On Veterans Day, we honor all who answered to a service call. Soldiers young and soldiers old fought for freedom, brave and bold. Some have lived while others died, and all of them deserve our pride. We're proud of all the soldiers who kept thinking of red, white, and blue. They fought for us and all our rights. They fought through many days and nights. And though we may not know each name, we thank all veterans just the same.
Thank you, veterans. There are not words enough. There is not a hug strong enough. All I can offer is thank you. You are my hero. You are in my thoughts. You are in my prayers. For all you've done, thank you for your service. Did their share. On Veterans Day, we honor soldiers who protect our nation for their service as our warriors. They deserve our admiration. Some of them were drafted, some were volunteers for some, it was just yesterday. For some, it's been many years. We owe so much to them who kept us safe from terror. So when we see a uniform, let's say thank you to every wearer.
If we can have all our veterans please stand, we have a gift for you that the kids made. If everybody could please stand. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Come on. Praise the Lord today, church. Praise the Lord. You are worthy to be praised today, Lord Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. You may be seated. We're going to keep the kids up here with us this morning for a few minutes, and I promise I'm going to be relatively quick. Again, I want to take just a second, though, and say thank you to our veterans for their service and their commitment to our country. Come on. Thank you for your commitment to the values of our country. You brought honor to your family. You brought honor to this community. You brought honor to our country. And in my book, all of you guys and ladies are heroes. So thank you. Now, I alluded to this a little earlier, so I'm just going to kind of dive on in. For those of you that don't watch the news, you might not realize that we had a little presidential election on Tuesday. Yeah. 145 million, somewhere, 145 million Americans voted. From what I understand, most all of them were alive. So that's a plus. Sorry about that.
It's all good.
But the immediate aftermath of this election, the last 3 or 4 days, I don't know about y'all, but it has been exhausting. It's been exhausting. It's been emotional. We have all felt it and continue to feel it. I dare say if we were completely honest with each other, we'd say, Pastor, I'm feeling it today. Yeah. We came into church sad. Came into church worried. Came into church confused. Even if your candidate won, what does it mean? Who's in charge of the Senate? Bunch of house races still not called. There's confusion in our land. So as a believer, as a Christ follower, how do we deal with this? What do we say? How do we respond? We got Thanksgiving coming up in a couple of weeks. We're going to break bread, and I guarantee you there'll be people at your dinner table that didn't vote the way you voted. So we're going to say, listen, you can't eat with us. No. No, we're not going to do that. Well, let me tell you, there's always extra turkey and ham at my house. Y'all can come eat with me. But how should we feel right now? And how should we respond to that feeling? Because, I mean, let's just break it all down right here. Just get just straight up. Some people are angry. Some people are hurt. Some people are joyful. Some people are numb. They don't know what to think. And this is the group I really don't understand. There's some people that just don't care. So what do we do with all of that? As we gather here this morning, I believe that there were a few things that God really laid on my heart that He wants me to share with you. We started off by reading out of Psalm 47. We're going to be in that chapter a little bit today. But verse 8 in Psalm 47 says this, God reigns over the nations. God sits on His holy throne. So what does that mean? It means God's in charge. God, He reigns over the nation. There is a higher authority than the President of the United States. Come on. There's a higher authority than the Senate Majority Leader. There's a higher authority than the Speaker of the House, and that is God Himself. God is, and God will always be on His throne. We can take hope in that. Second, it's a verse we all should know, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. We have a promise written in the Word. Can I tell you, when the Holy Spirit breathed on Jeremiah to write those words, he knew the outcome of the 2020 election. Before the first vote was cast, before the first ballot was printed, before the first candidate ever declared, God knew. And nothing that happened on Tuesday will thwart the will of God. Come on now. God is not subject to our will. Our choices do not change Him. Now, He very much should change our choices. Can we agree with that? So maybe you're sitting there saying, Pastor, I get it. God's on the throne, He's in charge, all that's great churchy platitudes. Those are great churchy words. But I need you to tell me something that's going to touch me here. What am I to do? The answer to this, it is so simple. But I'm going to tell you, for some, it is going to be profoundly difficult. Now, if you were here in my class Wednesday night, you heard a good bit of this. I was talking to a pastor friend of mine. We've been dialoguing back and forth, and much of what I'm going to say today, between that conversation and the Holy Spirit, birthed these words. So maybe you're sitting here today, and part of the hurt and the upset and the fear and the anger and the worry and any of those other emotions that you're feeling, you're saying, whose side is God on? Anybody thinking that? I mean, let's be real. Let's be honest with each other. Yeah. Whose side is God on? I hear pastor friends of mine asking that question, declaring that God is a Republican or God's a Democrat or He's a libertarian. I hear pastors saying, well, you know, God's a Biden man. And I hear others, well, he's all in for Trump. Whose side is he on? There's some interesting scripture in Revelation chapter 19 I want to read to you real quick. You know, John the Revelator, he's writing this, and he says, beginning in verse 11, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems, and he has a name written on him which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, are following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword, so that with it he may strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepresses of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. These verses clearly identify Jesus Christ as the ultimate commander of the armies of heaven, of God's army. And in these verses we read here, he is leading that final battle. He's leading those troops into this final battle that we refer to as Armageddon. You know, that end all, be all, settle it all, it's all done after this battle. Now, earlier in the Bible, if you go back to the Old Testament, back to the book of Joshua, there's another pre-battle scene that's set before us. Joshua, General Joshua, he's leading the troops. Now, Joshua has just taken over from Moses, one of the greatest leaders of all time. And he goes out on a little walk to inspect the line. I'm sure he was concerned. I'm sure he was worried. I'm sure he was wondering how it was all going to go. And we read here in verse 13, he says, now it came about when Joshua was by Jericho, he raised his eyes and looked, and behold, a man was standing opposite him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, are you for us or are you for our adversaries? And he said, no. Rather, I indeed come now as captain of the host of the Lord. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and bowed down and said to him, what has my Lord to say to his servant? The captain of the Lord's host said to Joshua, remove your sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy. And Joshua did so. What we've read there in biblical terms, theological terms, is called a Christophany. That is an example of Christ himself appearing before he walked in flesh, if you will. We believe that Christ appeared to Joshua standing there as captain of the Lord's army. Now, make no mistake, understand this, Jesus Christ is the commander of the Lord's army. Now, he seems to pop into this battle from another time, another dimension. He's battle ready. His sword is drawn. And I am sure that dear old brother Joshua was shook. I am sure that Jesus, standing there battle ready in a robe blood red, is an imposing figure. And he asked this question, are you for them or are you for us? I've always found this encounter fascinating. I've wondered, because we know that God is omnipotent. We know that God is omnipresent. He's all-powerful. He's everywhere. We know that he is every when at the same time. He doesn't see time the way we see time. God is timeless, spaceless. So could it be in this moment that Christ steps off the battlefield that we see in Revelation for that moment and steps in to Joshua's situation? And he says to this, I'm here for the Lord. See, that conversation with Joshua is so more powerful when you even think about it in this time and space layout there. Are you for us or are you for them? Neither. I come as commander of the army of the Lord from an impending battle scene of unimaginable greater consequence. And this is what he says to Joshua. What you need to do right now is worship. What you need to do right now is worship. Oh, Pastor, what? Worship? When we worship, it does a couple of things for us. First thing it does is it invites the presence of God. Right? And I talked about this just so briefly Wednesday night. Now, I really want you to get this because this is the most important thing I'm going to say today. What you worship shapes your worth. I'm going to say that again. What you worship shapes your worth. If you worship Donald Trump, your value will be found in Donald Trump, his ups and his downs. You worship Joe Biden, your worship or your value, your identity will be found in him. You put your worship in any human being, you are asking to be disappointed. Christ is saying to Joshua here, and I believe he's speaking directly to us when he says, listen, there's a battle raging. You need to know where your worth, your value, and your identity is anchored. What are you worshiping? Joshua fell to his knees and his face and got down on the ground and he worshiped. God and God alone is where we must place our identity. God and God alone is where we find our worth. God and God alone is where we find our value. God and God alone will sustain us through any situation.
Amen.
That same chapter in Revelation, John, right before the verse I read to you, if you back up to verse 10, John comes onto the scene and he faces an angel himself. And John says, then I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said to me, do not do that. I am a fellow servant of yours and your brethren who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. What in the world does that mean? When I testify to what Jesus has done in me, I'm prophesying for what Jesus can do in you. I am a sinner saved by grace. You are a sinner saved by grace. Can I tell you, your address, your DNA, where you're from, who your parents are, none of that matters. What matters is the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, oh, Lord, help me say this. Pastor, are you saying that President Trump shouldn't engage in legal battles for the presidency? No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that every American should want every legal vote counted. Period. Period. But what I am saying is this: while we may at some level be engaged in a battle, I want us to understand that in this moment that we are experiencing visitation from the commander of the Lord's army, the Son of God, the one that has conquered death, hell, and the grave, the one who stands in another dimension, another time, and another place, one that is positioned to lead us in the final battle, and he is saying to us, are you ready for what's to come? And we're saying to him, listen, are you for us or are you for them? And he's saying, open your eyes. Open your eyes and see, I represent the Lord. Not a side. This is the battle. Don't lose your depth perception. Don't lose your recognition for what is actually of eternal purpose and eternal consequence.
Amen.
There is only one thing that we can do as children of God to ensure that our perception is accurate, that our hearts are aligned where they should be, and that is worship. Yeah, I love history. Back in the day when you could go visit the White House, maybe 6 or 7 times I've gotten to walk through. It's an amazing place. And I visited replicas of the White House. I've seen the one that Gerald Ford set up at his presidential library. I've seen the one, and y'all can boo if you want to, that Bill Clinton set up at his. I've seen Jimmy Carter's, because he's in Georgia. The replicas of the Resolute Desk sitting there in the middle of that Oval Office, says, man, if you love this country, it makes your heart beat faster and you can just feel this lump in the middle of your throat when you imagine the things that go on in that room. But it matters not who sits at that desk. What matters is who sits forever on the throne. So I say this to you as your pastor. I am very concerned about our country. Well, why, Pastor? I'm glad you asked. I'm a numbers guy. Y'all know that. 58,000 people, troops, died in Vietnam, and that started a cultural revolution. 3,000 people died on 9/11, and we went to war in the Middle East. 235,000, or so people have had their deaths attributed to the coronavirus. And we're changing the way we do schools, we're changing the way we do church, we're changing the way we go to eat and interact. It's a revolution facing us. In the last 7 months, somewhere between 500,000 and 600,000 babies have been aborted. 235,000 people dying for corona or to coronavirus. That's terrible. It's a horrible number. We're fighting over that. Can we do more? I'm not seeing one article about babies. Not one. In the United States, we average over 900,000 abortions a year. It is estimated that since 1970, in the world as a whole, 1 billion, that's a B, billion, big number, billion, babies have been aborted. That number, by the way, does not count any babies that might have been aborted before it was a known pregnancy. What does that mean? The morning after pill or other pharmaceutical remedies. We don't have any way of knowing what that number is. So what are you saying, Pastor? I'm saying when we're fighting over stuff, we need to make sure that we're fighting over the right things. We need to make sure that our perspective comes from God and not out of our own fear, not out of our own anger, not out of our own hurt. So how do we keep our perspective in place? We worship. So yeah, I'm concerned about our nation. The Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We like that last half of that verse. The wages of sin is death. We don't like that first half so much. There will come a day when judgment will come on our nation for our participation in the genocide of tens of millions of babies. So what are you going to do, Pastor? Well, I did what I hope we all do on Tuesday. I voted. Andrea and I walked our little girls into the place, threatened them real good not to touch anything. Everybody listened but me. And we voted. We voted. And then what did you do, Pastor? I worshiped. I gave it all to God. I had prayed before I went in. I had prayed diligently. But then I worshiped after the fact. So this morning, we began by reading our call to worship scripture out of Psalm 47. And then even the first verse I read out of this sermon, God reigns over the nation and God sits on his holy throne. It's powerful words, right? But if you back up to verses 5, 6, and 7, I think you see something really interesting. It says this, God has ascended with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a skillful psalm. So what does that mean? It means before we can fully embrace verse 8, God reigns over the nation, God sits on his holy throne, we've got to get our perspective right, and that's by singing praises. Singing praises. That's by declaring with our voice, with our body, that Jesus Christ is Lord and Lord of all. So this is how we're going to conclude our service today. I'm going to ask you all to stand, and we're going to sing a couple of praise choruses. We're going to worship, church. We're going to worship because Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Come on. I don't know what songs they picked out.
Together. Love you.
worship anyway. Worship anyway. You gotta make a decision that, Lord, I am not gonna live my life beat up, beat down, torn down, disappointed. I'm gonna live my life in victory, because that victory was secured in you on a cross 2,000 years ago. So we're gonna worship. Let's continue to worship together. Come on now.
Scripture, are you for us or for our enemies?
The thought came to me that the question that the Lord is asking is, are you for me? Are we for him? I just want us to, we're going to sing, I sing praises to your name, and that goes into a simple statement, Jesus, you are my king. And I think that we just need to declare the Lord as our king this morning.
Amen.
Praise God that you got to go vote and not worry about getting shot. There's
There's something to praise the Lord for in every circumstance. Do that. Sister Gail has asked me to say this. There is a prayer rally today at 1 o'clock at the courthouse. I don't know how partisan it'll be. But if you are interested in praying for our country, praying for our nation, be there at 1 o'clock there in the courthouse in Hollidaysburg, correct? Know that I love you. Andrea loves you. We believe that now is the time that God has sent us here for this moment, this time. Amen? Amen. God bless you. You are dismissed. We will see you Wednesday night at 6:30 for prayer.